join us. Thank you, Dr. Ananda, for bringing us all together in this forum. Didn't want to go off this opportunity to interact with all of you. And thank you, all the participants, for taking time off this morning to hear us out. As Veena mentioned, these are challenging and very uncertain times for the education industry. And there is a significant amount of anxiety, especially amongst students, parents. And we as technologists, decision makers in the education space, policy makers, and corporates should come together in this time of crisis. Yes, it's a crisis, but it's also an opportunity for us to relook at old ways of education and look at deeply what is the challenge that is there and see how we can come together, collaborate and address the same. And to your question, Veena, at TCS, especially the business units focused on education that I run, we are deeply committed and focused on driving transformation and deeply understanding the root issues that are there and trying to see how we can collaborate to address them. And I want to take the top stakeholder expectation and perspective in this regard. Let's start with the students. In our interaction, in our research, one of the key things that students, millennials, Gen Zs expect out of today's education is bringing in contextualization and multimodality. Now, what does that mean? Intuitively, we all know we learn differently. Some of us are very good at learning through, reading. Times have changed today. Clearly, the millennials expect multiple ways to learn, whether it's doing, learning by doing, learning through collaboration, learning through assignments, mini projects, learning through hackathons. And as educators, as industry professionals, we need to use technology effectively to drive learning in a very engaging and multimodal fashion. That's the expectation from the student. Now, when we move to the expectation from heads of institution, and we've been interacting with some of our customers, partners in the education space, the biggest expectation that they have is there are a plethora of technology platforms, new way of doing things, but how do decision makers go about choosing the right model to engage? And that's a very big question in the minds of every decision maker today. So there are a lot of platforms out there. Some of them have been launched free, but the thing to bear in mind is it's not just the technology. It is also the challenge in terms of the adoption, the credibility of the institution, as well as most importantly, the time and investment that is going to be put in by a lot of stakeholders into any choice of a technology or a new model of doing things. And that's something that we keep in mind. While we are leaders in technology, we also want to ensure that technology is demystified and supported effectively so that it gets adopted and its full potential gets realized. So that's part of our conversation with every client that we discuss with. The third key stakeholder perspective that I want to bring out is from a faculty. And when you look at the faculty, the key thing that our research shows is that they don't want to be thrust and be told how to teach, right? And we all intuitively understand this. Every faculty has been teaching for a very long time. They have their own ways of doing it. And we at TCS do not believe that technology is anytime in the near future going to replace the traditional form of learning. What it best can do is to support new forms of teaching. What it can do is provide various toolkits, then we're going to see some of them today, so that faculties can leverage it and experiment with how they can combine traditional form of teaching with new age technology to be more relevant to the end recipient, which are students. Last but not the least, as recruiters ourselves, as a recruiter myself, I want to briefly touch upon the corporate expectation. And we have had multiple discussions, research, but the one thing that consistently comes across in all these discussions is hands-on skill. Today, a lot of the students who pass out from educational institutions do not carry hands-on skill, and that becomes a burden on the corporates to then step in and ensure that the gap gets addressed. And hence, most importantly, we need to answer how do we participate closely with recruiters such as TCS, such as industry that comes to recruit, and make sure that the curriculum is not just aligned, but also we give enough opportunity for recruiters, industry mentors to play a key role in bringing relevance to education. And that again is a very key dimension on most of what we do at TCS, which is contextualizing and making sure that education and teaching is driven in a manner where when the student passes out, he or she does not just have theoretical knowledge, but is able to apply it, solve real world challenges. So with that, I just thought I'll share my views and research and discussions that we've been having. Definitely look forward to the question and answers at the end of the session, and see how we can build and share best practices with each other to improve this thinking further. Thank you, Veena. Back to you.
Thank you, Krishna. Thank you for the right. Now, ask a question to Dr. Ananda. We have all heard, the critical stakeholder in this whole exercise is the faculty or the professor. Ma'am, can you explain how college is managing to upskill their teachers to deal with this technology? And also, one of the participants also mentioned that teaching digital platform is a huge change for the teachers, especially now that parents are also observing the classes going on. So how do you plan to help the faculty to deal with this kind of a stress?
Thank you. Before I start, I just want to say a very sincere thank you to TCS for taking up this challenge of co-organizing this program. And also to thank Dr. Krishna, Dr. Mazumdar, and Dr. Sandhu for very kindly agreeing to me about this discussion. Your question is a very relevant one, and I think this is something that a challenge that faces all of us. There are two levels of challenges. One level is going to be dealing with how students are going to handle this. It will come to that in a minute. Right now, they're looking at faculty appropriate. The entire shift in modality in how they're going to actually be doing it. These last 2 months when we've been on post lockdown, as it were, and we stopped working from home, I think a lot of my faculty in fact has been engaging in a lot of these webinars and courses, online courses, that will help them in actually designing their own syllabus to be presented through an online platform. One of the big issues for most of us who are a certain age or have had a certain number of years in teaching is that we have learned and mastered a particular range of pedagogical skills, and now suddenly those have to be unlearned and a new lot have to be put into place. This is a challenge, and we need to accompany our teachers as they face this challenge. So we try our best to make available various courses, various webinars that will in fact help them, but most important of all, give them the possibility of establishing digital dialogue with their students through some kind of platform of this kind that we've discussed.
So Professor Tenduka, I just wanted to understand, how do you measure the effect of the teaching process in your college? Dr. Anuradha, would you like to take this question?
So there are various matrices to evaluate whether the outcomes of the teaching, because teaching ultimately is directly linked to learning, and one of the main matrix would be to evaluate the examination outcomes. So unit wise also, as you know, question papers have a particular allocation to particular units of the syllabi. So based on the results of examination, that is one way. The other way of whether the teaching can be graded or we can evaluate would be feedback of students. The feedback of students, because they are the ones who are receiving the teaching and they are the learners. That is the second most important way of evaluation. And later on in today's way of accreditation, the various matrices do include other stakeholders, for example, employers, you know, and students, the alumni who have gone out into the world and are working somewhere or have started their own business. They get back with the feedback whether what they've learned is having any applications in their career or in their occupation. So these can be the various matrices by which we can evaluate teaching.
I know all of us always face this challenge. It's so difficult to keep the students attentive in a classroom. You know, physically when they are all in the class, there is so much of mischief and disturbances that are happening in the classroom. So in this challenge, how you are going to address to keep attentive? Have you all done some kind of experimentation, or do you have any techniques that you have thought through? Can you share some of them?
In the remote mode of teaching, the word attentive has no meaning as such, madam. Okay. We have been trying from the day when lockdown has started, trying to reach as many as students we can, either by the way of self, through email, through Google Classroom, through Easy Class. We have been trying. But the feedback what we have got it, I have got it from my teacher, that about 60-65 students, they haven't had access. But here I am saying just access, not a speed. When I try to conduct some sessions through Zoom, hardly 10-15% students, they could come online. So that is the difficulty what we are facing by now. Actually, this is a very sparse population, and it is concentrated in a several pocket aspect, and those pockets are in valleys. So wherever there is a valley, absolutely there is no connection. I mean, internet connection as such. So either they will have to come to some elevated area where there may be a likelihood, there may be a chance that to a certain extent they can. But access to the YouTube, some videos, downloading, uploading, that is, I mean, it's a very difficult. Even this is a place like a taluka place where I am actually. This is a taluka headquarter of Sangmeshwar Taluka. At the taluka headquarters itself, there are some many pockets where my own professors, they kind of have access even to the YouTube. That is the situation what we are facing. So as of now, holding online session, either teaching or examination, that is ruled out as far as the present info is concerned. But at the same time, I don't want to put it in the negative way, it is possible, provided we create necessary infrastructure with the help of companies like yours and with the support of government. But one more thing I would like to tell you, that we are catering here 70-75% students, they are socially and economically underprivileged. So the whatever investment companies would make, they just can't expect, or rather they can't levy some additional charges to the student. That is a very big problem. So I look at this particular perspective as companies out of which their CSR and some scheme from the government, that something could be done, but not at the immediate, if you see the present infrastructure and the present situation as such, it is very difficult to have these things online. That is what my admission.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Tina, can I add something to this?
Yes, yeah, sure.
See, our students are, as Dr. Ananda also said, that the pedagogy classically was classroom teaching. So they are conditioned to that. They have not been conditioned to online learning. Although MOOCs has been introduced by an MIT course, online course, way back in 2006. So some teachers have used YouTube videos in a blended mode during classroom teaching. So we will really have to analyze. Now, I'm a pharmacologist. So if you see the attention span when they are watching something on their laptop, if it is not a movie, it is something which, is study material. Maybe we'll have to create capsule modules of 10 to 15 minutes, on each subtopics, or two subtopics. The other aspect of classroom learning is because of the presence of peers along with them, the presence of the teacher in front of them. and the whole atmosphere of the campus or the class helps the learner to pay more attention, usually. That's the norm. Okay, so now we will have to, not only as Tendulkar sir said, you know, we'll have to create an entire ecosystem, the digital ecosystem for e-learning. And for that, government, I'm sure, after this scenario of the pandemic, which has led to lockdown and we will not be able to physically be present at places, I'm sure it will consolidate its digital infrastructure. Similarly, for universities, also we will have to build capacity, our competencies. So our competencies, as Principal Ananda said, as well as Principal Tendulkar said, has to be multi-verticals. For example, infrastructure competencies already is there, but we'll have to further bolster. Then competencies of teachers, training for creating e-content, delivering online teaching. And third is processes and procedures, which are many of the times paper-based. We'll have to digitize more and more processes. It also includes examination platforms, evaluation, result declaration, which in many cases, although we have digitized many verticals, but many still remain to be digitized. So as Principal Ananda said and Principal Tendulkar said, now we have worked as a crisis situation, but in the future, the digitization, this and learning through digital modes, even if it is blended along with classroom, would be more enduring and there would be long-term planning for it.
How assessments are going to be different for the learners now, and what is your college planning to do? How are you planning to administer the tests and assignments?
This is a core question. A question that is something that is exercising all our minds at the moment, especially right now when we're talking about, and there's much debate about, the fact that some classes are going to just be promoted, other classes are going to have exams, not going to have exams. There's much debate around that. And while we are waiting for a result, that obviously many of us are thinking of how are we going to go ahead with the test. Now, one possibility, of course, is MCQs, multiple choice questions. Also, objective questions which can be done online. Here, of course, there will be need for a number of safeguards put in place to ensure that a student working from home is not, using unfair means. Perhaps one way of addressing that issue of unfair means is also the fact that we can think of cameras, other forms of checking, but also that we ask the kind of question that requires application. Or perhaps we look at something, we explore possibilities of open book tests, which say, yeah, go ahead, look at the data, but you have to answer, you have to find your own answer, and you have to work out a way, apply that data, that information that you're getting. You have to analyze it perhaps. One big challenge is going to be particularly in the humanities, because I teach literature, so that is something that will be particularly a priority to me, is going to be that we cannot just have objective questions. These are people who are going to be graduates. We have to ensure that they are able to handle an essay type question, where they are working through a recent argument and so on. Now here, it's one thing when students are writing an answer. They're not yet used to typing for 45 minutes or 3 hours or whatever length of time that it is. So a lot of training of students to these different methodologies is going to be necessary as well. Because as of this minute, if you tell students, come, you have to do a 3-hour paper now online, I have a feeling they're going to be very nervous and very insecure and very uncertain. We're going to, as I said, we have to look up new methodologies, new pedagogies, New assessment techniques also are going to be thrown in.
Thanks. I think we'll now move to the question and answer from the participants. We see about 26, 27 questions already. So I will quickly ask the questions to the relevant panelists. So Yasmin Khan has asked, says, even if we manage to do some justice to teaching the theory online, how will the students of science be given practical experience? So, Dr. Anuradha, would you like to take this question?
Yeah, that's a very relevant question, which is coming from Yasmin. So what happens is, typically, nowadays there's a concept of virtual labs, which may not be applicable to wet labs like chemistry, you know, or anatomy or botany, where you have to do some kind of, you know, physical, that is hands-on experimentation. But that does not rule out the blending of virtual labs. In fact, Government of India, MHRD, has released a concept of virtual labs where there are 700 plus web-enabled experiments. Sometime back, we had a meeting with the Association of Commonwealth Universities, and many of the universities in England and other parts of the world are doling out, are giving online courses or programs, you know, like LLM, LLB could not be given, like Yasmin said, for nursing, for African countries, they have designed an online program. What they have done is to include the part of hands-on training, which will be required for a program of nursing, for example. In the entire program, they have kept 7 to 14 days of actual interaction, which takes place in different cities globally. It may be in a city in Africa, it may be in Sydney, it can be in London, it can be in New York. So they decide based on the cluster of learners. And then they actually go there physically, and that element of hands-on training they would take for those, you know, for those cluster number of days. But otherwise, the remaining part is given through an online mode. So although we cannot undermine the importance of hands-on practical experimentation, but we can blend it with online modes. Let's say procedural part explanation, principal explanation. Right? Many things can be blended with the online modalities or modes.
Thank you. There's another question from Gargi Bendre. She is asking about, with lockdown and inevitability of online, how do you address the problem of class and gender when it comes to access to internet and other resources? Since talking about gender, so I just thought this might be good for Dr. Ananda from the perspective.
Thank you. I think this is one of the topics that concerns me very strongly, because though we are a South Mumbai college and we are often considered an elite kind of college, we do have a very mixed socioeconomic profile for our students. And we have a large number of students who come either from lower middle class or students actually very economically deprived, etc. So given that, and even middle class families, if you think about it, how many laptops are there going to be in the house? How many PCs? We have to find ways where we are going to be able to make it possible for our students to have access to it on phone, because most of them do have individual personal phones. If there are two or three children, who's going to use the laptop if there's only one? If their both parents are working from home, who's going to use the PC, the laptop? The question cannot be ignored, because they're going to key and pivotal in this determining how on earth are we going to get this education across the world. Once again, you know, some years ago when we talked to our students and we said, okay, share some of the experiences when you have suddenly felt, okay, because I'm a girl, I'm being treated differently. And a number of people come up with this thing that the son is the foreign education or the very higher education. It's still, even today, in a country like ours, your mama for the son. I think the same thing will happen about access to the internet, access to technology. Until such a time like the technology becomes available at a very affordable level, it's still going to be.
Thank you, ma'am. Is from Dr. Suresh Sukar from Magar Chiplun. So I think this will take it to Dr. Tendulkar. I hope his. How is it possible that online teaching can be done if rural area is lacking in digital infrastructure? Can you suggest how the and get remedy on it is what he's asking. So Dr. Tendulkar, can you share how you are making in your campus, how have you got the benefits of technology available to your college, though you are from a remote area? And
it's a real problem, but what happened, teachers, they can prepare their videos and they can upload it from the Google Drive and they can send the link to the student. Okay. So, if of course, in the remote area, there is no net and there is no chance of getting downloaded, he has to come little away from his home, where there may be a chance of getting accessibility for the net. But the problem still prevails that downloading video, it's a matter of bandwidth. Sometimes even the video having a time, say 17, 18 minutes, it takes even a couple of hours also. Sometimes it gets sorted out within a fraction of minutes. So that is what you can say, his fortune. Mm-hmm. So it is left to, because we all are staying at the mercy of BSNL, you know. Even we have a lease line in our campus, half the time that lease line is also not. It's so special, we are the privileged customer. And with the privileged customers, they are facing this kind of problem. Then what about the net pack? That is something 2 GB and for the 24 hours. So his question is genuine and it's very difficult. If the students are coming in the campus, then of course every institution definitely they may be having some lease line, special lease line. Only thing is that even there are financial constraints for the rural colleges also. Like if we go for say 8 GB, 1:8. If we want to upload the video, then certainly that 8 will not, then we will have to go for 1:2 or at least 1:4, then subsequently cost but doubles three times like that. So that has to be upgraded, and we need to talk in terms of lakhs of rupees. So those constraints are there. Video downloading, that is ruled out, but only text they can send it, like some assignment they can send it. That part they can do it right now. And as what madam talk about practical.
We have another question, ma'am. This is for Dr. Anuradha. What steps are you as University of Mumbai government taking to provide digital infrastructure to the different colleges?
See, the university has digitized several of the platforms. As you know, now we have OSM for assessment. All teachers who are part of the University of Mumbai system are aware that it is on screen marking for exam assessment. Then when it comes to academic audit of colleges affiliated to the university, it is online communication of the details for affiliation and the details for affiliating, you know, every year, those who are not permanently affiliated. These all have been digitized and turned into online platforms. From enrollment to admission to hall ticket generation, filling of examination fees online. So the university has digitized several of the procedures. Several colleges per se, if you see, they themselves have tried to bolster and upgrade their infrastructure with respect to presence of computers, with respect to enabling and training their administrative staff and their faculty for the same. Now, what I would like to again thrust upon is this situation of COVID-19 pandemic and lockdown has been unprecedented, and it's a crisis situation. We were caught unawares. The entire global community was caught unawares. And I think more than around 1.6 billion students globally, which amounts to around 91% of the student community across pan global, are affected and impacted adversely by it. So I think in the future, when the long-term planning is being designed by the state government and by the university, infrastructure development and upgradation would be a very, very key feature. And that would be a feature which we would like, because we would like to brace ourselves and prepare ourselves with such kind of eventualities. It would be a contingency plan. Again, I want to say that classroom teaching can never be undermined. That is the human touch which, you know, between the teacher and the student. But yes, we would also have to parallelly bolster our e-learning and LMS systems, the learning management platforms and systems. For that, university will help and facilitate colleges. Colleges themselves have always nowadays, because of the demands of NAC and NBA of AICT, have tried to build on their LMS systems. So in recent years, because of the government requirements, many colleges have bolstered their infrastructure, including having a learning management system. But yes, not all colleges. There is a digital divide here, as Principal Tendulkar said, and we are trying to bridge it. The process would try to bridge it. But I would also like to add here, the government is taking a lot of efforts. If you see the Swayam platforms, the NPTEL, ARPIT, which is also online platform for teachers' refresher courses, government is also trying to give a backup support for using the online. If you see Swayam, the word YAM means the young aspiring, the youngsters, the participants who are the learners. Similarly, the NPTEL also talks about enhancing learning using online platforms and digital platforms. So I think this will really grow over the years, and government will take a key role in trying to build capacity, in developing an ecosystem for digitized or digital learning.
Thank you, ma'am. Okay, there's another question which is talking about, Krishnan, maybe you can explain on this. On the online platforms, how can we watch over unfair means and students?
Yeah. I mean, it's a very standard question that comes because one of the areas that a lot of institutes, universities are looking at is how do they conduct the assessment, especially for the final years. Who are there in campus, because they need to clear the assessment, get the certificate, and get to job, because campus hiring would have completed for them. So there are technologies out there, and we at TCS also we have our own remote proctoring engine, which has capability to arrest many of this browser switching or disallow other applications to run. There is an AI engine that looks at if the candidate is looking away or looking at his mobile phone. It detects other similar systems to the conducting of the assessment. So there, it's a longer conversation, but yes, technology does exist to avoid such malpractices. But having said that, I guess I would agree with Dr. Ananda and Anuradha that time has come to relook at how examination needs to be done, because in the real world, if you really look at it, everyone has access to all the knowledge. So it's not about theoretical knowledge that is important. It is about starting to test on how can student answer questions where even if they know all the knowledge in the world or have access to look it up, they should definitely be able to measure the deeper level of analytical and application capability that is more mimicking the real world environment. And if we study the UGC's guideline on examination, It does talk about giving the opportunity for universities to undertake assessments in that regard, which are open book, do-it-yourself, project-based assessment. So definitely, I guess we should move into that. It's if we mix A and B, combine technology and a smart way of setting the questions, I guess we should definitely ensure that the certificates and assessments are free of malpractices.
I think this question would be better for Dr. Anuradha. The question is from Seema Purohit. She's asked, how do we teach subjects like mathematics and physics, which are heavily dependent on blackboard teaching?
I think there is a lot of element of creativity which will come into developing creation, and as Krishnan said, the curation of our lectures using online mode. So it's not that it is impossible, but for physics or even for chemistry, you know, when we write the formulas on the board, we show the reaction, it has an impact. But that doesn't mean that there aren't online courses available which teaches physics and chemistry with elan, okay, and that too for high level examinations. And as Krishnan said, the millennials, we always call nowadays call them as netizens, are so e-savvy, they are so net internet savvy that they grasp it. Their perception is different from us who have studied during the 90s and maybe, you know, in the 80s. So they are much more grasping. They are in a different zone if you compare our perception to theirs. And we will have to really use our creativity to teach subjects like physics, chemistry, anatomy, I would say. There are some very wonderful open learning resources which amaze me by the way they have simplified the concepts so well. But yes, we cannot, as Madam said, we cannot undermine classroom teaching, one-on-one interaction with the teacher, real-time solutions provided to students, and the classroom environment. And when they do those experiments in the lab, when Yasmin also asked for chemistry or for some other subjects which are very hands-on, it clicks. The grasping or cognition, as you say, the level of cognition when you do it is much, much better and of the higher order. But as Krishnan said, it cannot be only one mode. We have to use multiple modes to give the best possible learning resources to the student by way of projects, interaction with the industrialists or industry people who are in the corporate or in the industry, interacting with the alumni who are in the field. It is a mix. It's going to be a mix which will give us the best learning outcome, and that will best be judged by our students. The students would be the main stakeholder and the main judge whether they are satisfied by the modes of teaching imparted to them.
And Veena, if I may add, taking the cue from Dr. Anuradha is and going back to the question, I think the time has come for teachers, faculty to abstract themselves a little bit higher, because today, if you see, as opposed to say 10, 15 years behind, there's enough good content available in platforms like Khan Academy, YouTube. There is a plethora of content. So it is not today difficult for a student to look it up. But the question is, which is the content that they should look it up, right? Because there are content out there that is not teaching it correctly. There are content that is good quality. And hence, it is the role of the teacher to be able to possibly curate that content and not focus on creating the content, because creating content takes time. Content already exists. So contextualization and curation and a platform that enables that seamlessly would be an idea to explore further and experiment further with.
Okay, I think we have had a very interesting, very insightful, enriching experience shared. Radha, Dr. Ananda, Dr. Tendulkar and Krishnan, thank you very much for patiently answering all the questions, sharing us your insights, your best practices, And thank you, participants, for very actively engaging with the panelists, asking very relevant questions, pertinent questions.